Hello and welcome. Thank you so much for joining me. This is my first video for Toll Town. That's a tongue twister for me today. Anyway, we're going to be painting this project called the Spring Bunny Bunch. And it is painted on a Masonite plaque that I got from Cupboard Distributing. It's called the 10-inch William plaque. And we're going to be using some decoupage, adding some interest to our background. We're going to be using Punchinello to stencil and add interest. We're going to do a regular decorative painting, and then a little bit more decoupage, and then some inking with an IdentiPen to bring these little bunnies to life. So let's get started. The first thing we're going to do is we're going to decoupage some tissue paper onto the background to add interest to that background. Now, I like to use a text background tissue paper. I find this at Hobby Lobby, but you could use any kind of tissue paper that you like. I know there are some with arrows out there or scrolls, anything that's not too prominent of a design. You just want it to be something that will add interest to the background but not take over the piece. So I'm going to be using DecoArt decoupage medium in the matte, and I use this a lot for my pieces. If you painted any of my stuff, you'll know that. And I use it so much that I like to keep it in this little canister because it's a much wider mouth for me to get my brush in, and it keeps it real handy for me. So I'm going to start applying decoupage onto the piece, and I kind of work a section at a time because the decoupage will dry relatively quickly, and this way you can use it while it's still wet. So I just apply some decoupage and then lay a piece down, or you could do it all one piece if you wanted, or I was just using scraps that I had left over from other projects. So I'm going to be ending it using a few pieces to cover this background, but you could use one piece. That would make it really easy. And let's see, there we go. Now I smooth it out with my hand, which means I get a little bit of decoupage on my hand, but that's okay. It's like when you were in elementary school and you used to rub glue on your hand and then you'd let it dry and peel it off. That was always fun when I was a kid. If you didn't do that, then you missed out. You should do it now. So hopefully this last piece will cover. Let's see, I like torn edges, so. There we go, cool. And when you get the surface covered, then you want to give a coat of decoupage on top and smooth it out with your hand. Don't be afraid to get decoupage on you. It'll come off. Soap and water, no biggie. Wrinkles are okay. Bubbles, not so much. If you find a bubble, try to smooth it out with your fingers. Usually you can turn a bubble into a wrinkle. And wrinkles just add more character. So, let's see if we can get this glued down fairly well. As you work on this project, you may find like an edge or something that's not glued down completely. And that's no big deal. You just come back with some decoupage and glue it on down. Okay, so there we go. Get this out of the way. And then I'm an impatient painter, so I always like to dry my stuff. Sometimes if you have a bubble too, as you dry it, it will shrink up and you'll be fine. So we're going to dry it. I like to use this Ranger Heat-It Craft Gun. I got it on Amazon, like $22. And because I like to dry things quickly. When I get an idea in my head, I want to run with it. And that means I dry things in between. It gets hot, but not too hot. It's not going to, like, burn the hair off the back of your hand or anything. So it's not going to hurt your piece. I wouldn't use it to dry varnish. Varnish might bubble. But as you can see, this is pretty dry already. And that was really quick. The next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to take an emery board and I'm going to sand the excess, or file the excess tissue paper off the piece. I put tissue paper as a background, unless it's a stretch canvas or something. This is usually how I do it. You know, it gives it a nice clean edge, and it's easy. There we go. Nice background. Now we are going to take a baby wipe, just any old brand will do, and some Blue Haven. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to take the baby wipe and I'm going to add some color to this background by using the baby wipe to wipe some Blue Haven on the piece. And the reason I do this is because I want to keep the Blue Haven transparent. I want to be able to see that text from the tissue paper. But I wanted to give it some color. So, and if you get a little bit more Blue Haven in certain spots, it's okay. That just adds to the interest. Dry that again. I love to add interest to my backgrounds, and sometimes it's just as simple as a spattering or stenciling. So experiment with your pieces. If you look at it and it looks a little blah, stencil some dots in the background or spatter or do some little scrolls. It doesn't have to be something that takes away from the overall design, but adds to it. Okay, pretty dry. So now I'm going to apply the pattern for the basic design, and I did include this little base coating pattern for you. And I have these pens that are actually quilting for quilters. They're called Frixion. They're by Pilot. And I really like to use them to apply patterns, especially when I'm applying patterns for classes at conventions and stuff, because it's colored. This is purple. So then I can tell where I've already gone when I'm applying my pattern. And I'll show you another cool thing about them, because sometimes I'm prepping, you know, 35, 40 pieces, and with these I've been able to get by with only having to use like two copies of the pattern, as opposed to doing five or six and then having to get another new copy. So all my little bunnies are on there. And let's get our basket. All right. There you go. So with this, I don't know if you can see the purple on there or not, but like in this area here, and I just hit it with my heat gun, and the purple disappears. So I can use it on the next piece and see where I've applied and where I haven't, and comes in handy if you have to answer the phone. All right, another one of my favorite tools is Punchinello, and I like to use it again to add some interest to the background. You can see it here. It's just a little bit of color to again bring some interest and some character to the background. So I am going to use I like to use cosmetic sponges to apply paint with when I stencil. And I'm going to use warm white. Let me grab some warm white. Luckily, I don't have to go far to get it. And I use DecoArt paint. They're great paint and they treat me well, so here we go. I like to fold the sponge in half. These are not quite as dense as the cosmetic sponges that I usually buy, and so I found that I need to fold these in half. But if you have a stencil brush, if you're comfortable with stencil brushes, then by all means use a stencil brush. But I'm just kind of randomly putting bunches of dots on the background here around the bunnies. If I get it on the bunnies, it's okay. It's not going to hurt because we haven't based them in yet. Sometimes I do this as an afterthought. I'll look at a piece and think, oh, it just needs something to punch up the interest. And so I may come afterwards and do this. But just randomly add clusters of dots. Okay, let's see, maybe a little bit there. So there. That's cool, and I have a few different sizes of Punchinello. It depends on what comes in the package the day I order it. So this is Punchinello, the tissue paper. It's all available on my website if you can't find it near you. So the next thing we're going to do is we're going to float some shading on the background around the design elements. So I'm going to be doing that with a large flat brush and colonial blue. And you want to blend it out really well so that it's not a real dark shade. So, and I'm just going to go all the way around the design. Across the bottom here. And as you can see, I'm a pity-pat floater. I like to play and work with my floats. I just have better luck with them that way. And one of the advantages to doing this before you do your base coating is you can get it onto the design itself, and it doesn't matter because you're going to base coat over it. Now, if you like to mop out your floats, which a lot of times I do, soften them like that, by all means get out your mop brush and soften those floats a little bit. If it's looking a little too stark to you, then just blend it a little bit more. So, when we get done, see, like that's a little stark for me. So I'm going to blend it out a little bit, soften it. Let's go here. And when we get done with the shading around the design area, we're going to go around the outside edge of the piece also. Let's see, let's go in here. We've got a few little areas that are little V areas that need to be floated in. You can bounce around your piece. Let some floats dry while you go and do others. About the float right now, it doesn't have to be perfect because, again, I'm going to base coat and straighten that out. But you just want to have this here so it will lift the design itself off of the background a little bit. So, I basically have this part done. I think you have the idea. I am going to break away for a minute and do the shading around the outside edge of the piece. And then I'll be back and we'll do some base coating. All right, we're back and we're going to be doing some base coating. And you'll read this in the pattern packet, but I took the liberty of naming my little bunny crew, and so I'll probably be referring to them by their names during the course of this class. This is Keister Bunny, this is Easter Bunny, this is Carl, and this is Boo. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to base coat Keister Bunny and Boo with Oyster Beige. And I'm going to base coat Easter Bunny and Carl with bleached sand. So Oyster Beige and bleached sand. So let's get that base coated and then put on the detail pattern for their faces, the carrots inside their ears, and for their tails, if they have them, and feet. Okay, so Oyster Beige, bleach sand, and then apply the detail pattern. All right, we're back. And I've got the pattern on for my little faces and feet and ears. So we are going to start by working on Keister Bunny. I call him Keister because he has his back to you. And all you can see is his backside and his Keister. So the first thing we're going to do is we're going to dry brush some highlighting on Keister Bunny, on his backside and his ears. And I will show you how I like to dry brush. But, sorry, put a brush on the floor. Had to bend over and pick it up. If there's a way that you like to dry brush, then by all means, use that technique. Whatever works best for you. I'll just show you what I do and then you can take it from there. So the way I like to dry brush is I like to use a Langnickel short round brush, and when you buy them they have points like this newer one, but as you use them they start to lose their points and flatten out a little bit, and as they flatten out they become even better dry brushes than when they're pointy. So I like to take this brush, put some paint out on my palette. We're going to dry brush with bleach sand. And so I'll pick up some paint and I'll start rubbing it around on my palette in a circular motion at changing directions. And what I'm doing is I'm working that paint through the palette. Now we started with a dry brush, no water in the brush. And the next thing I'll do is I'll use this towel that I have underneath my piece and just kind of wipe out some of the paint. And then I go to my hand, to this area right here. And when I hit my hand and start rubbing it around, I can feel that it's kind of cool. Not cold, but cool. And as I rub it around, it loses its coolness. When it's not cold anymore, that's a pretty good indicator that you've taken out enough paint from your brush that you can go to your piece and start dry brushing. Now, this might not show up a whole lot, but it's there and you need to do it because I did, okay? That's what I tell my class. Anything I did, you have to do. So I'm just going to dry brush some warm bleach sand highlighting through the center of his ears. If I run out of paint, I just go through those steps again of loading and blending and wiping it on my brush and on my hand. And then I'm going to dry brush on his other ear. And I'm going to dry brush through his body. Don't go all the way to the edges. I just keep it mainly in the center area. All I'm doing is trying to give it a little bit more shape, more roundness. It's not a technically correct, realistic looking bunny, so I'm not going to sweat about that too much. Okay, so I've dry brushed some bleach sand on him. And as long as we have dry bleach sand in our brush, we can go ahead and dry brush highlighting on the little bunny, on Boo, too. So you're going to do his on his ears. And if it gets in the center, that's okay, because you're going to paint over that. But I want to get a little bit of lighter color on his ears. I want to go across his forehead and his cheek area, down his body, under his mouth, and his pacifier, in case you were wondering what that was. And I'm also going to go on his little foot. So as long as we have bleach sand in there, we might as well pop over here and get him dry brushed on too. Okay, you can wash out your brush when you're done with that. We are going to float just a little bit of color across Keister's little bottom with dragon fruit. Now you want to blend this out really well. You don't want it to be a real bright pink. You want to keep it kind of soft and sheer. You just want to pink up his hiney a little bit. So I'm going to take, I turn my piece a lot, and I'm just going to give him some pink on his bum. That might be a little bright, but I'll just kind of use my mop brush and blend it out a little bit, and that softens it up. So he's got a little pink bum. The next thing I'm going to do on Keister is I'm going to float some shading on him with mink tan. And let's see if we can get a little closer on him so you can see. There we go. Maybe that'll help a little bit. It's hard when there's nobody here to tell me, hey, you're off camera. You guys can tell me all you want, but I won't be able to hear you. And you always want to keep a picture out in front of you so you can kind of see where the shading is. We're going to shade on his ears next to his body to separate his little ears from his body. And I'm going to shade on his body next to the bunny next to him, which is Easter Bunny. I'm going to turn my piece a little bit so it's a little easier for me to do. So on his body, next to Easter Bunny, and right on down next to the basket. I'm going to shade on his ear next to Easter Bunny's ear. Hopefully you won't do that. I had the brush turned the wrong way. even after I checked it on my palette. I still managed to mess that up, but oh well, it worked out. I'm going to float on his body around where his tail is going to go. That can just be pity-patted around there. Doesn't have to be a perfect little circle, because obviously his tail is going to be fluffy and not a perfect circle. I'm going to go down both sides of his ears. Basically, every edge on this little bunny gets a float. So both his ears, down both sides. And then you're also going to go down both sides of the bunny's body itself. So he basically gets shaded all the way around. We are going to stipple, I'm pretty sure everybody knows how to do that, stipple in his little tail with bleach sand, which was the color we used to dry brush highlighting. You just want to give him a fluffy little tail. And then I'm going to pick up a little warm white and give him a little bit lighter fur on his tail. All right, so we have one bunny done. I'm going to pause for a moment and pull paints for our little boo bunny. And then we'll come back and work on him. Okay, now we're going to work on our little boo bunny. We've already dry brushed highlighting on him. So the next thing we're going to do is we're going to take either a liner brush or a small round brush. And we're going to wash in the inside of his ears. And we're going to paint his nose. And we're also going to thin down the mix a little bit and paint the pads of his feet. And that's dragon fruit plus some bleach sand. We just want to make a little bit lighter value of dragon fruit. So mix a little dragon fruit with a little bleach sand and paint inside his ears. Could be she, but I think it's a little he, I don't know. Can be whatever you like. So inside the ears, his little round nose. And then you want to thin that down even a little bit more and paint the pads on his feet. Three little ones and one larger one. We're also going to dry brush some cheeks onto all of our bunnies with dragon fruit, just straight dragon fruit. So the three bunnies that have faces, you want to go ahead and give them their cheeks. As long as we have dragon fruit on our brush. That might be a little bright, but we'll make it work. So just nice round cheeks on all three bunnies. Now, we're going to float some highlighting in the top of each ear, of the pink part of the ear, the top of the nose, and the top of the pads on the feet with floats of warm white. Okay. So I'm going to go in the top of the inside of each ear. With warm white. The top of this is little round nose. And the top of each pad on his foot. Now you need another color that you don't have out on your palette yet, red violet, and we're going to float some shading in the bottom of each of those areas that we just floated highlighting. So the bottom of the inside of each ear, the bottom of his nose, and the bottom of the pads on his feet, we are going to float some red violet. Done. Alrighty. You already have mink tan on your palette, so I'm going to take a liner brush and I'm going to make a little wash of mink tan. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to line a little bit of a shadow above his nose. So it's just like a little line of mink tan above his nose to act as a little bit deeper shadow. And I'm also going to do that around the top of his little pacifier that we haven't painted in yet. And above the pads on his feet. So just a line of thin down mink tan. Above the pads on his feet, above his little pacifier, and above his nose. We're going to base in his eyes with lamp black. And as long as you're at it, you can base in the eyes on the other two bunnies too. That'll just save us a step when we get to them. So he has a couple little eyes. And they're just little ovals. Just base them in completely. Don't have to be the same size. I always kind of make them different sizes. Just kind of adds character. Try to keep your hands out of them. Three sets of eyes, based in with lamp black. They all have teeny tiny little eyelashes that you paint with thinned lamp black. So thin some down with your liner brush and just give them some teeny tiny little eyelashes. Not too much, just a few little ones. And you can do that to all of your bunnies. They're starting to get personality now. Now, each one of the eyes, as long as you have warm white still open on your palette, each eye gets a little highlight dot in the top. And I usually dot with my liner brush. But if you want to use your stylus, you can. So just a little dot in the top of each eye. Whoops. Then there's going to be a new color that you haven't had on your palette yet. We're going to use the color Laguna. It's a very pretty blue. I think it's one of the newest colors that DecoArt has. And what we're going to do is we're going to add just a little touch of this Laguna blue into the bottom of each eye, just to give them some color. It's kind of like just a little stroke. And that just gives them a little bit more personality. All right. Now back to our little Boo Bunny. I'm going to give him, he's the only one, but I'm going to give him a couple little eyebrows. And I'm going to do that by mixing a little bit of bleach sand and a little bit of lamp black, not too much. And I'm just going to give him a couple little eyebrows above his eyes. You can't hardly see them, but they're there. Okay, we are going to paint his little pacifier in with Laguna. Think like a pacifier. I always called them a plug. I have to pull a couple more little colors, so I will be right back. And I'm back. And we are going to float some highlighting in the top of our pacifier with Laguna plus a touch of warm white, just a lighter value of Laguna blue. And I'm just going to float that across the top of the pacifier. And then I'm going to float some shading with Victorian blue. And that goes in the bottom of the pacifier. There's a little stripe. I think if you look at one of the close-up pictures, you can see it, of Victorian blue that's lined around the edge of the pacifier. It's set just inside the edge a little bit. So we want to do that, just a little decoration. And then we're going to paint the handle, which is just a little circle and a little thing to hold it in place. Okay, and then I just wiped out my liner brush. It still has a Victorian blue in it. And I picked up some warm white because I want to line a highlight on that little handle. There. We're going to float some shading on our bunny. Again, with mink tan, just like we did with our first bunny. And basically in the same places. We're going to go on his ears next to his head. This one, you just kind of skip that middle pink part. Going to go on his little body next to the bunny next to him and to the basket. Oops, got a little blue. Guess I should probably dry that first. See, it happens even to us. Continue that down on his foot a little bit. I'm going to go above his foot on his body. So that brings that foot out in front. going to go in the tops of his ears. Going to go in the bottom of his little foot. And then I'm going to go down the sides of his body, across the top of his head, and down the other side. And he's going to look much different even when we do our detail lining. So don't worry about him too much just yet. He has some little freckles on his cheeks that are just dots of milk chocolate. So just little teeny tiny dots of milk chocolate on his little cheeks. And then he has a tail that is, where did my other, you just stipple that in with warm white. Just a teeny tiny little tail. Okay. And there you go. So we have two bunnies down, two to go. I'm going to pull paints and I will be right back. All right, back again. We are going to dry brush some highlighting on Easter Bunny and Carl with warm white. Just like we did on the other two bunnies, we're going to dry brush that on the ears. And you should be able to see this. On the body. If you can get on his little forehead, that'd be great. Let's do Easter Bunny's ears. His body. Okay, I'm not exactly sure why, but my camera decided it didn't want you to see me basing in the bunny's noses with black. So you just get to miss that part, even though it was the most important part of the video, because you know how hard that is to base in little triangles with lamp black. So we're going to move on to some shading on these guys. And the shading is done with desert sand. So we are going to shade basically in the same places that we did on the other bunnies. So I'm going to start with shading on their ears next to their head. Guy. And this guy gets some. I'm also going to shade along the bottom edge of both bunnies next to the basket. Even though that's going to be covered up with flowers, little bits of it may peek through, so it'd be just be nice to have a little bit deeper color back there. So all the way across the bottom of the bunnies. Just roll your brush through that paint, Sandy. That'll work just fine. I'm going to shade in the tips of their ears, the tops of their ears, actually. So this guy that's folded over, that would be this lower edge of his, the folded over part. You also want to shade a little bit in that fold to show that that's folded over. Right, let's go across the tops of their heads. Clean off that eye a little bit. And we also want a shade to separate Carl from the Easter Bunny. And then I am going to shade just a little bit on the sides. I don't go up too far, but just a little bit up the sides. I also want to touch some shading under this guy's mouth. And a little bit around this guy's mouth. Even though it's just a straight line, you want to get just a little touch of shading there. We're going to dry brush some highlighting across the top of their noses with warm white. So just a little bit of a highlight on the top of their nose. The mouths are lined with thinned milk chocolate. Carl just has a straight little mouth that just kind of starts here and goes up to the center of his nose. And then Easter has the typical little curvy mouth that shows off his jowls. And while you have thin milk chocolate on your brush, your liner brush, you can go ahead and give them just a couple little freckles on their cheeks too. All right, we're going to move to those ears on these guys. And what you're going to do is, they're basically carrots, so you're going to wash in the carrot part of their ears with spiced pumpkin. I'm going to make a little wash. And I'm just going to kind of base in that little triangular shape of a carrot. It doesn't have to be opaque, obviously, because it's a wash. This one ear that's folded over has a little tip of a carrot. Just little quick easy triangular shapes to form the inside of their ears. You've got that one a little high, but we'll work with it. We want those to dry a little bit. We're going to float some shading on the inside edge of each of those carrots with burnt sienna. So I'm just going to, and it's a rough float, so you kind of pity-pat it and drag it across. It doesn't have to be perfectly straight along that edge because it's a carrot, and carrots are rough. They don't have smooth little surfaces. So, just on the inside edge, just to carrot it up a bit, make it look a little bit more like a carrot. And you'll add more creases and stuff when we come back with our ink work. With a large, a round brush or a liner brush, you're going to take some Hauser medium green and you're going to tap in the tops of those carrots. It's not rocket science. Obviously, I'm not a rocket scientist, but I'm just going to tap some greenery on the tops of the carrots. It doesn't have to be opaque. Thank you. get those dry real quick. I'm going to float a little bit of Hauser Dark Green along the bottom edge of those carrot tops. Just to add some shading along the bottom edge. Just makes them look a little more carrot toppier. That's not a word, I know, I make them up as I go. And then you're going to float just little touches of olive green in the top of the carrot top. Just to add some highlights here and there. So you see, I just kind of floated and dabbed that light color in there. Okay, so we have the inside of the ears. Now I felt like this bunny just needed its shading to be a little bit deeper. So I'm going to come back with very well blended out floats of burnt sienna. And I'm going to deepen shading like above the head on the ears. And that just helps tie the inside of the ears together with the rest of the bunny too. And I'll do the top or tips of the ears. It's also going to help to tie in your inking a little bit better too. Top of the head. And I will do it on this float that separates the two bunnies from each other. I'm not going to worry too much about the float along the bottom because most of that gets hidden anyway. All right. So the next thing you're going to do is you're going to base your basket in with honey brown and then apply the pattern for the weave and also the pattern for the flower shapes. So I'm going to base in my basket with honey brown and apply the pattern for the weave and the flowers, and I'll be back. Okay, so my basket is painted honey brown and I have the pattern on for the flowers and for the the staves in the basket. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to dry brush some highlighting with marigold in each of those sections that makes up the weave on the basket. And you might, yeah, you should be able to see it. If you don't worry. We are going to dry brush even brighter highlights. So you just treat each little section as its own little area to be highlighted. Okay. Now we're going to float some shading with milk chocolate. I'm going to go underneath the top and middle section of the weave. So I'm going to drop down here and float. And then I'm going to drop down and float underneath that middle section. My brush picked up a little bit of milk chocolate and put it where it shouldn't be. I'm going to let that dry a little bit, or dry it real quick. And then I'm going to float on either side of each one of those vertical staves. So I will go through and float down one side on each one. And then I'll come back and float down the other side. So you end up with a back-to-back float at these sections. It'll start looking like a basket now. One side done, I'm going to dry this. And then I'm going to come back and do the opposite side. It doesn't matter if they don't line up exactly, if there's a little space in between, we're going to line the staves in there. So you'll be just fine. Hopefully it should start looking like a basket more and more with each step that we do here. Dry that. And then I'm going to float down the sides and across the bottom with milk chocolate. And as you can see, I'm going right through where the flowers are. Just to keep it a finished looking. Okay, let's dry that. We are going to dry brush that brighter highlighting on each section with Moon Yellow. That brightens that back up, that weave back up. Oops, a little too bright. But it'll be okay. You're going to take some burnt umber and your liner brush, and now you're going to line each one of those vertical staves. So that's why I said it didn't matter if your back-to-back floats didn't quite match up, it would be okay. So just a line of burnt umber down the middle of those back-to-back floats you did. And then you're going to pick up a little bit of moon yellow on your dirty liner brush. And you'll line a little highlight through the center of each of those little staves. Okay, and now we're going to do one more float. We're going to darken the shading down the sides and across the bottom of the basket with some floats of burnt umber. So just across the bottom and down the sides. Right. And it'll even look more like a basket when we get that ink work done on it. Okay, so if you haven't already, put the pattern on for your flowers. And we are going to paint our leaves with Hauser Medium Green. So let's see if I can get the right amount of leaves. And here again, it doesn't have to be opaque because we're going to put stuff on top of it, you know, highlighting and shading. Should be an odd number of leaves. And if you want to add more leaves, you're welcome to. Maybe you want to put some tinier little filler leaves somewhere. That's fine. It's your spring basket. One more leaf right in here. And if I didn't, I do now. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven. Good job. An odd number. This one I want to give it a little bit more color. All right, seven leaves. Going to float highlighting across the top edge and above the center vein line with olive green. get to decide what the top edge is. And it looks kind of bright, I know. It'll be okay. I'm going to turn my piece around. Let's go here. And this guy. And one more. Okay, let's dry that, and we are going to float some shading on the lower edge and next to the center vein line with Hauser Dark Green. So the opposite of where you floated the highlight, you're going to float the shading. Okay, and we have leaves. We are going to work on those round pink flowers first. So you're going to need dragon fruit and warm white and red violet. So the first thing you're going to do is you're going to base in those circles, quasi-circles, with dragon fruit. There should be three of them. Okay, and then what you're going to do is with your dirty brush, you still have dragon fruit in your brush, you're going to pick up some warm white and make a lighter value pink, and you're just going to start lining some squiggly kind of half circles in there. Leave a little space in between them to act like the blossoms, you know, are separated by something, but it's not real rigid or anything. Okay. And then just wipe your brush out. You don't even have to wash it out. And you're going to line some darker rows of petals in the bottom with red violet. And you can get those up into the light color that you painted earlier. And don't worry, these aren't the only flowers on here, so they're not going to be the ones that everybody's going to be just spying on. And then what I did is I like to pick up a little bit more warm white and just punch up here and there some of the lighter petals. Okay, quick and easy little pink flowers. The yellow flowers, which are the flat, kind of odd-shaped ones, you're going to paint them in entirely with moon yellow. So you see they're not perfectly shaped. I'm going to dry my pink flowers a little bit before I get in there. They have a very uneven edge. And there are three of those. Let's dry those little flowers. We are going to float a highlight across the top of those flowers with warm white. I'm going to turn my piece a little bit. And then I'm going to float some shading on the bottom edge with burnt sienna. I guess I put that away earlier. So just a touch of burnt sienna. Float that into the bottom edge of the flowers. Kind of oranges them up a little bit. All right, I'm going to dry that just a touch. Now I'm going to take my liner brush and kind of, when I load it, I'm going to flatten it out so it kind of has a thicker square tip. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to pick up some moon yellow and a little bit of warm white to make a lighter value moon yellow. And I'm going to go around what would be the center of this flower and just stroke on some petals. They don't have to be perfect petals, but I'm just gonna add some petals to them because I didn't want them to just be blobs. I think you can see that, okay? So I'm just kind of stroking around what would be the center. It helps if you turn your piece a little. I was trying to do it without turning. That wasn't working so good. So don't make it a career. They're just little quick petals just to add some more character to your flowers. Flower's character is very rough. Okay. And now I'm going to take some burnt umber and I'm going to stipple in the centers. You can use a small stippling brush, or you can use, I'm sure we all have filberts that are kind of messed up because they don't seem to last as long. So I always hang on to them because they make nice little brushes to stipple with in these little areas. So I'm going to stipple the center in with burnt umber. And then I'm going to take my liner brush and I'm just going to add a few little warm white dots around the lower edge of the center. Okay. Another set of flowers done. Now the white flowers are just your basic little daisy type flowers. And all I did for those is I stroked on the petals around the center and I didn't shade them, I didn't highlight them, I didn't do any of that stuff. Just quick and easy petals. That go around the center. And they will look, they'll stand out a little more after you do your pen work because we outline each one of these little petals. So just little white daisy-like flowers. All right. Quick and easy. And the center on those is I picked up some burnt umber and some lamp black, just a little bit, mainly because I didn't want to bring another color in, but the burnt umber needed to be a little darker. So just a little burnt umber and a little lamp black. And I just did kind of swirly centers. They're not perfect swirls. But I just kind of did some little circles and swirls. That looks like a copyright statement. There you go, basket of flowers. So we are going to let these flowers dry, and then we'll start working on our ink work. And what I'll most likely do is record the whole process of inking and then just kind of speed it up, if I could figure out how to do that. Okay, so I did the ink work on this piece with the small side of an Identipen that's in brown. And you can get this at Michael's. Black would be a little too harsh. So I went with the brown one. If you can't get it at Michael's, you can always order it on Amazon.com, where you can order almost anything these days. So all I'm going to do is I'm going to add some little nervous outlining, and you want to probably look at your picture to make sure you're just outlining what, not more than you need to, because I didn't outline everything. I think I need a new pen. Not a problem. Because I have plenty. Sometimes they just get a little too gunked up. Okay. Well, much better. So I'm basically going to outline the bunnies. Like I did Bunny's foot, and his ears and the inside of his ears, but I left everything else alone on him. So let's back up so you get the whole piece. So I'm just going to outline here. I'm not going to talk because I wouldn't know what to keep saying. So just speed through this if you'd like, or let it run its course. Okay, I stopped it after I got done with the basic design area because the next thing I'm going to start working on is this these words and letters that run around the border. Now, if you didn't want to do that, you could always just do like a little border line to finish it off. You wouldn't have to write the little words and letters. And if you want to do the words and letters, I wouldn't put the pattern on. I just kind of eyeball it. And if you end up with too much room left, just add another word in there or change the wording. It doesn't really matter. It was just another thing to add interest to your piece. So I'm going to start writing the lettering around the edges. And then after that, we'll do this decoupage on lettering and we'll be almost done. So here we go. I probably should put this piece by me so I know what I'm going to write. Okay, so I've got my lettering all the way around. The next thing you're going to do is make a copy or print out another copy of the lettering for the word spring. And then do that, and then we'll come back and I'll show you how to apply that to your piece. All right, I have my copy of the word spring. And if you wanted to print out your own words, just experiment with different fonts and stuff. If you want to print out a different saying with this font, I did give you the name of the font and the size that I used. But I'm going to cut this word out. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to cut each individual letter out into its own little rectangle, which they'll require a little bit of trimming. I like to give you space in between your letters so you don't feel like you have to have a precision cut. Right. So then what I want to do is I want to lay this out on my piece to make sure I spell the word right, first of all, and also just to kind of get an idea of how I want to place this so I can see that I need to move this over a little bit. And I don't like to line them up like little soldiers. I like to have them be a little bit of cattywampus. So I think I like that. So I'm going to get my decoupage out again and a brush. And what I like to do is I like to take the finger, my index finger on the on my hand that I'm not painting with. And this is why God gave you spit. I just lick my finger a little bit and pick up one letter at a time. Put some decoupage down and then put that letter back. Just don't breathe hard or run a fan or anything, otherwise they'll all blow away. So just a quick little coat of decoupage. This one's gonna... This is the easiest way I've found to do this. Okay, and then after I get them glued in the spot that I like, I'm going to give a coat of decoupage to the top of them. There you go. So then let's dry this. I probably could have put them up a little higher, but oh well. They're all a little different. Okay, the next thing I like to do is, because this paper is so white, what I'm going to do is I'm going to take a flat brush and make a really thin wash or a glaze of burnt umber. And I'm going to just wash that over that white paper just to tone it down a little bit and make it more part of the design than standing out on top of it. Just knock that white down a little bit, and that helps. I'm going to dry it. Then I'm going to take a liner brush, and with thinned burnt umber again, I'm going to line a shadow to the left and the bottom of each rectangle. And that just kind of helps to pop the letter off the background a little bit. So left and bottom of each rectangle. Doesn't matter what's behind it. Just line that shadow. Left, if it gets on the white paper, that's okay. Does not matter. Left and bottom. All right. Let me dry that. We have one more thing to do, and then I think we can call this done. Except for your varnishing, and if you wanted to drill a couple little holes to add a wire hanger. So I'm going to come back with my brown Identipen, and I'm going to very roughly outline each rectangle. Could be on the paper, could be off the paper, but this just ties it in with the rest of the piece. So, there you go. We actually made it through a whole piece. Thank you for watching, and I hope you've enjoyed this project for Toll Town, and I look forward to bringing you another one in the next couple of months. If you have any questions, you can always email me. My email address is on the directions. It's easier than me trying to tell you on the video. So you have a great day, have a wonderful spring, and I'll see you in a couple months.